Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Nimisha Jadhon from School of Studies Environmental Chemistry, Jivaji University, Gwalior. Today we are going to discuss about the flame emission spectroscopy under the paper of Fundamentals of Analytical Chemistry. The learning objective of this module including introduction and principle of flame emission spectroscopy, then the main components which are used in flame photometry, the different types of burners, the determination of non-metals or the alkali earth metal by using this flame emission spectroscopy method. The flame photometry is based on the measurement of intensity of the light emitted when a metal is introduced into the flame. The wavelength of the color tells us what the elements is, and the color intensity tells us how much of the element is present. In early experiments, the visible colors of the flame was used to confirm the process of certain elements in the samples, particularly alkali metals and the alkali earth metals. Later, the whole ultraviolet and the visible range was utilized by using the spectrophotometer. This instrument permitted us to select the wavelength of the radiation and the measure its intensity with the considerable accuracy. The spectrophotometric techniques has proven to be one of the most reliable and the easily used technique for the determination of the concentrations of sodium, potassium, calcium and the magnesium. The flame photometry is also named as flame emission spectroscopy because of the use of flame to provide the energy of excitation to atom introduced into the flame. The flame photometry is also successful in determining certain transition elements such as copper, iron and manganese. In addition to the determination of metals, it can be applied to non-metal analysis by using the infrared region of the spectrum. Now we discuss here about the limitations of flame photometry. The concentration of the metals may be measured by flame photometry, but frequently that technique is not the method of choice because of the relatively low energy available from a flame and therefore the relatively low intensity of the radiation from the metal atoms, particularly those that required large amounts of energy to become excited. Although flame photometry is a means of determining the total metal concentration of the sample, it tells little or nothing about the molecular forms of the metal in the original sample. It has not been used for the direct detection and the determination of the noble metals, halides or the inert gases. All of these elements require more energy than the flame provide in order to become excited. Now we discuss here about the general principle of flame photometry. When a liquid sample containing a metallic salt solution is introduced into a flame, the processes involved in flame photometry are complex, but the following is a simplified version of the events. The solvent is vaporized, leaving particles of the solid salt. Then the salt is vaporized or converted into gaseous state, and then a part of all of the gaseous molecules are progressively dissociated to give free neutral atoms or radicals. These neutral atoms are excited by the thermal energy of the flame. The excited atoms, which are unstable, quickly emit photons and return to lower energy state
eventually reaching the unexcited state. The measurement of the emitted photons, that is radiation, forms the basis of flame photometry. The permitted energy level of all the atoms can be represented in the form of diagram, like such diagrams are sometimes known as Grothian chart. Here, this is the type of Grothian chart of energy level of lithium. Here, you have seen that the lithium emitted types of radiation in the range of 610 to 6460 nanometer. When it is ionized, it will change the energy level and come back to the ground state energy level. If E2 and E1 represents the energy of the higher and the lower energy levels concerned, the radiation emitted during the jump may be defined by the equation E2 minus E1 is equal to h nu, where h is the Planck constant and nu is the frequency of the emitted light, which is defined as follows by the equation nu is equal to c by lambda, where c is the lambda is the wavelength of electromagnetic radiation and c is the constant. On combining equation 1 and 2, this resulted that E2 minus E1 is equal to hc upon lambda, and where the lambda is equal to hc upon E2 minus E1. From this equation, the one can calculate the wavelength of the emitted radiation, which is the characteristics of the atoms of the particular element from which it was emitted. When flame photometry is employed as an analytical tool, the wavelength of the radiation coming from a flame tells us about the elements which are present in that flame. Also, the intensity of the radiation enables us to know the amounts of those elements present. The following is a concise description of the sequence of events that normally occurs in flame photometry. Here in this graphical representation, the liquid sample containing elements aspirated into a flame that is converted into the formation of a liquid droplets, and then the evaporation of the droplet resulted in the formation of the residue, and then the decomposition of the residue happened into the neutral atom and the formation of the excited atoms, and the emission of radiation from the atoms is also result. The wavelength and intensity of emitted radiation measured by flame photometry. A portion of the neutral atoms or radicals formed in the flame may combine to form new gaseous compound. As the formation of these compounds decreases the population of neutral atoms and hence the intensity is also decreased, this constitutes the chemical interference in flame photometry. The fraction of free atoms that are thermally excited is governed by the Boltzmann distribution, which is denoted by the following equation: N excited divided by N naught is equal to delta E to the power minus delta E upon KT, where N excited is the number of excited atoms and naught is the numbers of atom remaining in the ground state, and A a constant for a particular elements. Delta E is the difference in energy of the two levels, and K is the Boltzmann constant, and T is the temperature of the flame. The temperature of fuel is controlled by the types of fuel and oxidants used. The sum flame temperature are discussed here in a given table.
The flame is a source of intense radiation, especially for atoms inside the flame. It is probable that this is a source of excitation of the atoms, that is the radiation excitation, which augments the thermal excitation expected from the Boltzmann distribution. Because the flames are a low energy source, they populate the first excited energy state even reasonably Well, but the upper energy state E2, E3, etc. only poorly. The flame photometry therefore utilizes the resonance transition from E1 to E2 or E3 most commonly and other transition only under the special circumstances.
Now we discuss here about the instrumentation of flame photometry. Here, block diagram of the equipment used in flame photometry is shown in this figure. The instrument possesses the same basic component as the spectroscopic apparatus has. However, the basic components are source, microchromator, slit system, and the detector system. The flame photometer also includes a burner, which is utilized for burning the sample solution and exciting the atoms produced in the flame after burning. The various components of the instruments are described here. Number one is the burners. The flame used in the flame photometer must possess the following functions. The flame should possess the ability to evaporate the liquid droplets from the sample solution, resulting in the formation of solid residue. The flame should decompose the compounds in the solid residue formed in step number 1, resulting in the formation of atoms. Number 2, the flame must have the capability to excite the atoms formed in step, and the number 3, and cause them to emit radiant energy. For analytical purposes, it becomes essential that emission intensity should be steady over reasonable period of time up to an 1 to 2 minute. The temperature of the flame, which is primarily responsible for the occurrence of the above mentioned process, is controlled by several factors which are summarized as number 1, the type of fuel and oxidant and fuel to oxidant ratio. The next is the type of solvent for the preparing the sample solution. Then next is the amount of solvent which is entering into the flame. Then next is the type of burner employed in flame photometer. The particular region in flame which is to be focused into the entrance slit of the spectral isolation unit. In flame photometry, several burners and the fuel oxidants combinations have been used to produce the analytical flame. Some of these are discussed here. The number one is the Meeker burner. This burner was used earlier and employed natural gas and oxygen. As this burner produced relatively low temperatures and low excitation energies, this was generally used for the study of alkali metals only. The flame produced by Meeker burner is not homogeneous chemically. It means that there are different regions in the flame, that is an oxidizing region and a reducing region appear in the flame. As the processes leading to atomic excitation in the flame differ in the oxidizing and reducing regions in flame, different concentrations of excited atoms are obtained in these regions. The next one is the total consumption burner. A typical total consumption burner. In this burner, the fuel and the oxidants are hydrogen and oxygen gases respectively. In this type of burner, the liquid sample is drawn into the flame from the side tubings. Hydrogen and oxygen are entering and both are burning at the top of the burner to produce a flame. As soon as the liquid sample is drawn into the base of flame, the oxygen aspirates sample solution, leaving a solid residue. Atomization and excitation of the sample then follow. The name total consumption burner is used because all the samples that enters the capillary tube will enter the flame regardless of droplet size. The flame produced by total consumption burner is noisy and turbulent but can be adjusted to produce high temperatures by proper control of fuel to oxidant ratio. This burner was used for the number of years, but its use has been stopped and replaced by other types of burners. The third one is the premix or the laminar flow burner. This burner uses energy, it is considered as an energy type of burner. Aspirated sample, fuel and oxidants are thoroughly mixed before reaching the burner, opening and then entering the flame. In this burner, the gases move in non-turbulent fashion, that is in laminar flow. An important feature of laminar flow burner is that only a small portion, about 5% of the sample in the form of small droplets, reaches the flame and is easily decomposed. By the easy decomposition, it means that an efficient atomization of the sample in the flame will take place. The larger droplets from the aspirator impinge on the side of the spray chamber and are drained off. Thus, in this burner, 95% of the sample may be wasted, thereby resulting in a loss of sensitivity. However, this loss must be balanced against the loss of larger droplets.
The flame produced by a premix burner is non-turbulent, noiseless and stable. Another advantage is that in this burner, easy decomposition of the sample takes place, which results in an efficient atomization of the sample in the flame. The premix burner can handle solution up to the several percent without clogging. The main disadvantage of the premix burner arises when the sample contains two solvents. When this is aspirated into the flame, the more volatile sample will be evaporated in the spray chamber, leaving the sample in the form of undissociated atoms in the less volatile component. Thus, another number of the atoms would reach the flame, and this will reduce the emission intensity, giving incorrect results.
Next is the lunge guard burners. In the lunge guard burner, the sample must be in liquid form. It is aspirated into the spray chamber. Large droplets condense on the side and drain away. Small droplets and vaporized sample are swept into the base of the flame in the form of cloud. The various devices have been used to enhance the nebulization stage in this type of burner. These include the use of the impact bead, ultrasonic vibrator, and more recently thermo spray heaters. An important feature of this burner is that only about 5% of the sample reaches the flame. The rest of the droplet condense and are drained away. This is a significant loss in atomization efficiency and therefore sensitivity. The difficulties may also arise if there is any selective evaporation of the solvent in the spray chamber. In particular, if there are two solvents, the more volatile will preferentially evaporate, leaving the elements of interest in the less volatile component. The latter may drain away, taking the sample with it. In this event, many of the sample atoms never reach the flame and the emission intensity is reduced and an incorrect analysis obtained. An advantage of the lunge guard burner is that it is physically quiet to operate, which is a distinct advantage over the noisy total consumption burner. The efficiency of the lunge guard has been improved by putting an impact bead immediately before the nebulizer. This impact bead has the effect of breaking up large droplets as they emerge from the nebulizer, thereby increasing the number of small droplets and consequently the efficiency of nebulization. The atomization step is very different on the efficiency of the nebulization, since the droplet must be evaporated and the residue broken down to liberate free atoms after introduction into the flame. The number of factors affects the drop size, that is D naught, including viscosity eta, density P, surface tension gamma of the sample solution, gas, and the quantity of aspirated solution psi and liquid, and the velocity of the nebulizing gas. These variables are resulted in the empirical expression shows here. Diameter D naught control the volume to surface relationship or shorter means. It can be seen from expression that it is important to maintain constant viscosity, surface tension, density, and flow rate of the pertinent gas to reproduce the nebulized drop size and therefore the emission atomization process intensity. To that end, it is essential that the standards and the sample be analyzed under identical flame conditions, and that the solvents and matrices be as close to each other as possible. Now the next one is the shielded burner. The T.S. West developed shielded burner in which the flame was shielded from the ambient atmosphere by a stream of inert gas. This shielding leads to a quieter flame and the better analytical sensitivity. Here in this table shows the result obtained with the commercial equipment based on this technique and developed by Beckman Instrument Corporation.
Now we discuss here about the nitrous oxide acetylene flames. During research in atomic absorption spectroscopy, J. Willis and M. Amos independently found that nitrous oxide acetylene flame were superior to other flames for efficiency for efficiently producing free atoms. This was particularly true for metals with very reflective oxides such as aluminium and titanium. However, the high temperature reduces its usefulness for the determination of the alkali metals because they are easily ionized. The one problem encountered with this type of flame was the intense background emission, which makes measurement of the metal emissions very difficult.
This table shows the percent ionization in the flame. The elements including lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium, or the manganese. And here is the different types of flames and their temperature. The sequence of events occurring in the flame is rapid succession is given as below. The water or the other solvent is evaporated and leaving minute particles of the dry salt. The dry salt is vaporized or converted into a gaseous state. A part of or the all of the gaseous molecules are progressively dissociated to give free neutral atoms or the radicals. A part of the neutral atoms may be thermally excited or even ionized. A portion of the neutral atom or the radicals in the flame may combine to form new gaseous compounds.
Now we discuss here about the mirrors. The radiation from the flame is emitted in all directions in the space. Much of the radiation is lost and the loss of signal results. In order to maximize the amount of radiation used in the analysis, a mirror is located behind the burner to reflect the radiation back to the entrance slit of the monochromator. This mirror is concave and covers as wide a solid angle from the flame as possible.
The third important part of the flame photometry is the slits. With the best equipment, entrance and exit slits are used before and after the dispersion elements. The entrance slit cuts out most of the radiation from the surroundings and allow only the radiation from the flame and the mirror in reflection of the flame to enter the optical system. The exit slit is placed after the monochromator and allows only a selected wavelength range to pass through to the detector. For many purposes, it is essential that this wavelength range be very narrow, that is of the order of a few nanometers. This is necessary if emission lines from the other components in the flame have a wavelength similar to those of the emission line of the elements being determined. The slit must prevent such interfering lines from reaching the detector. The next part of the flame photometry are the monochromatics. In simple flame photometers, the monochromator is the prism, but in expensive models, the grating monochromators are used. The quartz is the material is the most commonly used for making prism, even though its dispersion power is less than that of glass. The reason for this is that quartz is the transparent over the entire region. The grating monochromator employs a grating which is essentially a series of parallel straight lines cut into the plane surface. Here in this picture, the monochromator system shown without collimator lens for simplification. The stray radiation from the source is after entrance into the slit, then it enters to the monochromator like the prism. It is irradiated the sample to the exit slit and then diverted or the absorb the extra radiation and only directed the desired radiation passing through the exit slit.
Now we discuss here about the filters. In some elements, the emission spectrum contains a few lines. In such cases, wide wavelength range will be allowed to enter the detector without causing any serious errors. In such a situation, an optical filters may be used in place of the slit and the monochromator system. The filters is made from such a material which is transparent over a narrow spectral range. When a filter is capped between the flame and the detector, the radiation of the desired wavelength from the flame will be entering the detector and is measured. The remaining undesired wavelength will be absorbed by the filter and not measured. The flame photometer which use filter monochromator are very convenient for single repetitive analysis. However, such instruments can be used for a small number of electrons. The reason for this is that a large number of filters are employed. Now we discuss here about the detectors. The radiations coming from the optical system is allowed to fall on the detector, which measures the intensity of the radiation falling on it. The detector should be sensitive to radiation of all wavelengths that may be examined. In good flame photometers, the photomultipliers detectors are employed, which produce an electrical signal from the radiation falling on them.
Now we discuss here about the effects of solvents in flame photometry. The solvent used in the sample affects the signal in two ways. First, viscosity controls rate at which the sample is aspirated into the flame. There is an optimum sample flow rate which has to be experimentally determined. If the flow rate is too great, the flame is swamped and the signal drops off. If the flow rate is too low, then the signal is decreased because insufficient sample finds its way into the flame. The second effect of the solvent is caused by the difference between aqueous or other organic material. If it is aqueous, then the sample requires energy to evaporate it. Generally, an inorganic salt is left which requires more energy from the flame to decompose it. These are two endothermic steps which slow down the atomization process. On the other hand, if the solvent is organic, it burns on introduction to the flame and usually leaves an organic residue which in turn burns inside the flame. Each of these steps is exothermic. The atomization efficiency is increased and there is an enhancement of signal. This is the reason for signal enhancement when organic solvents are used rather than aqueous solvents. It can be seen from these comments that in order to get good quantitative data, it is necessary that the sample reduction note, the solvent used, and the flame conditions, including the fuel and oxidant, be the same for both the sample to be analyzed and the preparation of the calibration curves. Any variations in these conditions causes a major variation in flame intensity and therefore in the analytical data obtained. Now we discuss here about the instrument. There are a large varieties of flame photometer in a widespread use, ranging all the way from very single beam filters photometer to multi-channel spectrometers with automatic background correction. The number one is the first type. It is the simplified diagram of a flame photometer in which the sample is aspirated, then the excited radiation is transported by the collimated mirror and passed through the prism, which is detected by the photo detectors. In the second type of instrument is the internal standard flame photometer. An internal standard flame photometer, the lithium is used as an internal standard and an equal concentration is added to the standard and sample solution. The sample solution containing internal standard lithium is sucked by an atomizer operated by one of the flame producing gases and as a fine spray is fed into the flame. The emitted radiation is collected by the mirror through a filter. The emitted radiation from the mirror is divided into two parts. Number one part arises due to the internal standard, that is lithium, whereas the second part arises due to the presence of element to be measured. Both these parts are received by separate amplifiers and are then fed to the common detecting system, which records the intensity of the element to be determined to that of the internal. Thus, this flame photometer gives a direct and simultaneous reading of the ratio of intensities. This is the schematic diagram of the internal standard photometer.
The use of this flame photometer removes the effects of mandatory fluctuations in flame characteristics caused by the fluctuations in fuel or the oxidant pressures. Therefore, internal standard flame photometers is better than the first type as discussed above. In internal standard flame photometers, the errors due to differences in viscosity and the surface tension are minimized considerably. However, the effect of radiation may or may not be reduced depending on the similarity of the effect on the two elements.
Now we discuss here about the application of flame photometry. The number one application of the flame photometry is the qualitative analysis. The flame photometry is only used to detect elements of group number 1 and 2 of the periodic table. These elements are sodium, potassium, lithium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, and barium. Some of these elements can be detected visually by the color in the flame. An example is sodium, which produces yellow lines, but this method is not very reliable. However, the best method is to use a flame photometer with a filter or monochromator to separate radiation with the wavelength characteristics of the different metals from other radiation present. If the radiation of the characteristic wavelength is detected, this will indicate the presence of a metal in the sample. The method to carry out detection of elements by flame photometry is fast, simple, and if carried out with care, and quite reliable. However, this method faces with some difficulties which are outlined as this method is less reliable than atomic absorption spectroscopy. Then this does not provide information about the molecular structure of the compound present in the sample solution. Known radiating elements such as carbon, hydrogen, and halides cannot be detected by flame photometer. However, these can only be determined under special circumstances. For example, if chlorine is to be detected in a liquid sample, the best method is to precipitate it as silver chloride, which is then aspirated into flame of a flame photometry to carry out the determination of silver. From the result, the chlorine content can be calculated. The second one type of application of flame photometry is the quantitative analysis. This is one of the most useful applications of flame photometry. This is used for the rapid quantitative determination of the elements in group 1 and 2 of the periodic table. If high optical resolution equipment is used, other metallic elements beside that of 1 and 2 groups can also be determined. Here in this table, there is a list of elements with their emission wavelength and detection limit. All the elements present in this table have been determined successfully by flame photometer. That included aluminium, antimony, arsenic, bismuth, barium, and calcium. Miscellaneous applications. Flame photometry is very important in the analysis of biological fluids and tissues. In these elements like sodium, potassium, aluminium, calcium, cobalt, and iron are detected by flame photometer. Flame photometry has been used for determining sodium, potassium, aluminium, calcium, cobalt, and iron in soils analysis. It has also been used for natural and the industrial water, glass, cement, petroleum products, and metallurgical products. Boron has been determined in various types of organic compounds. Now, the interferences in the flame photometry. The radiation intensity may not accurately represent the sample concentration because of the presence of other materials in the sample. These materials result in an interference in an analytical procedure. It is only through adequate control of this interference that flame photometry would provide good analytical results. Following are the more commonly encountered interference process in flame photometry. Number one is the spectral interferences. The first type of spectral interferences arises when two elements or the compounds may exhibit different spectra, but their spectra may partially overlap and both are emitted at some particular wavelength. In this case, the detector cannot make distinction between the source of the radiation and will record the total signal. Thus, an incorrect answer will be obtained. This type of interference is more common at high flame temperature because numerous spectral lines are produced at high temperature. An interesting example is that the iron line at 3247.28 angstrom overlaps the copper line, that is 3247.54 angstrom, and the iron lines at 2852.13 angstrom overlap the magnesium line, that is 2852.12. angstrom. This type of error can be overcome by removing the effect of interfering elements effect by using extraction method or using calibration curve which are prepared from a solution having similar quantities of the interesting elements. The second type of spectral interference can occur if spectral lines of two or more elements are close but their spectra do not overlap. This type of interference is especially troublesome when a filter is used as a spectral isolation device. With a filter, spectral lines separated by as much as 50 to 100 degrees centigrade may be passed through the filter to be detecting limit, thus resulting in an incorrect readout signal. The possibility of such interferences can be decreased to a considerable extent by increasing the resolution of the spectral isolation system. However, the interference cannot be eliminated entirely due to the use of finite width of the spectral isolation sample and the finite slit width in such system. The third type of spectral interferences occur between a spectral line and a constant background. This type of interferences arises due to the high concentration of salts in the sample. This occurs especially in the salt of alkali and alkali earth metals. Continuous background is also produced by some organic solvents. An example is methyl isopropyl, methyl isobutyl ketone, which is particularly troublesome in flame photometry. Thus, this type of interference can be detected by the scanning technique. The organic solvent in a simple way influences the emission intensity of spectral line by changing the viscosity and surface tension of the liquid, which in turn alter the rate at which the sample is delivered to the flame. In addition, organic compounds also affect the temperature of the flame itself through their contribution to the heat of combustion and enhancement of the line's intensity is the usual result. The next type of interference is known as ionization interference. In some cases, some of the metal ions are interfere and make ionize in high temperature flame. For example, sodium at high temperature converts into the sodium plus and electron releases. The sodium ion possesses an emission spectrum of its own with different frequencies from those of the atomic spectrum of sodium. Thus, ionization decreases the radiant power of the atomic emission. The interferences due to ionization can be overcome by adding a large quantity of potassium salt to all of the solution unknown and the standard. The addition of the potassium prevents the ionization of the sodium, but it itself undergoes ionization. Thus, the sodium atom emission is enhanced. This type of interferences is requested to the elements of the first group of the periodic table. The third one is the cation-cation interferences. Mutual interferences of cations have been observed in many cases. Cation-cation interferences invariably decreases the signal intensity of the element present in the sample. These interferences can are neither spectral nor ionic in nature, and the mechanism of their interaction are unknown. An example of cation-cation interference is that aluminium interferes with the calcium and magnesium, and also sodium and potassium have cation-cation interference of one another. Now the next is the oxide formation preference. This type of interference arises due to the formation of stable oxides with free metal atom if oxygen is present in the flame. Thus, the emission intensity is lowered because the large percentage of the free metal atoms have been removed from the flame. All the alkaline earth elements form oxides and are subjected to this type of interference. Now the next is the cation anion interference. The presence of certain anions in the solution may affect the intensity of the radiation emitted by the electron and thus resulted in a serious analytical error. For example, anions such as oxalate, phosphate, sulfate and the aluminate may affect the intensity of the radiation emitted by an element. For example, calcium in the presence of phosphate ion apparently forms a stable substance so that the calcium signal is depressed because it will not decompose so easily, resulting in the production of lesser atom. Another example is that a given concentration of barium sulfate produces low emission intensity than the same concentration of the barium chloride, because of the barium chloride can be broken down more easily than the barium sulfate. This type of interferences can be removed by extracting the anion or by using calibration curves which are prepared with the same predominant anions at the same concentration in the standard solution as that found in the sample. Factors that influence the intensity of the emitted radiations in flame photometer. A number of factors will influence the intensity of the light emission from a given solution. Some of these are as follows. Viscosity, the addition of a substance which increases the viscosity of the sodium decreases the intensity of the light emission. Thus, decrease result is due to the reduction in the efficiency of atomization. The next is the presence of acid. When an acid is present in the sample solution, this decreases the light intensity. This decrease arises due to the disturbance of the initial dissociation equilibrium. Then the presence of other metals. If other metals are present, these also enter the intensity of emitted radiation. In order to remove this effect, especially filters are used which will absorb radiation due to the element which is to be estimated in the sample solution.
Now we discuss here about the determination of non-metals. The determination of non-metals by flame photometry has two major handicaps. First, the atomic state is usually not stable. For example, chloride, chlorine does not exist as chlorine Cl but as Cl2. The second, the resonance lines are in the vacuum ultraviolet. High energy is necessary to cause electronic excitation, more energy than is available in conventional flames. The atomic emission of non-metals has not been exploited in flame photometry until recently, and even then only using the research grade equipment. However, molecular emission has been observed. These are band spectra rather than the line spectra and are therefore less intense, analytically less sensitive, and more open to spectral interferences. So at the end of this module, we can conclude that the flame photometry is based on the measurement of the intensity of light emitted when a metal is introduced into the flame. The flame photometry is also named as flame emission spectroscopy because of use of a flame to provide energy of excitation to atom introduced into the flame. The flame photometry is used in determining the total metal concentration of the sample, and the basic component of the flame photometry are that, for example, source, monochromator, slit system and detector system was also discussed here in this module. Thank you so much.